evening. This is Sylvia Johnson, and I am sitting in for Haki Ami, the success scholar, this evening. And so this evening, I am so excited. I am so excited because we have a caller. Many of you who are in the Prince George's County area of Maryland know this person who's coming on. We have been looking forward to getting this interview going. We are having Angela Alsobrook. Angela Alsobrook is the Prince George's County State's Attorney. And so Ms. Alsobrook has announced that she will be putting her bid in for the Prince George's County executive position. So Ms. Alsobrook will be calling in a few moments. And so we are so very excited. She's online? Okay, great. So let's pan her in.
Good evening.
Good evening, Ms. Alsobrook. How are you?
I'm doing wonderful. Thank you so much for having me on the show.
I am so excited about this interview. First of all, let me thank you for taking the time out of your schedule to make this possible. We are so very excited. So thank you very much.
Oh, it's wonderful to be on the show.
Thank you. So, I read your bio, and so I'm just going to hit some of the highlights, but I want you to fill in those blanks. So, yeah, raised in Camp Springs, Maryland, and you're currently...
Raised in Camp... I'm a native Prince Georgian.
Okay.
And I was born... The first home I lived in was Suitland, Maryland.
Mm-hmm.
Also lived in Hillcrest Heights, and then had... my parents have been in Camp Springs for the last 34 years, so I am a proud Prince Georgian.
Right, you are deeply rooted. You are deeply rooted. And you're a graduate of the University of Maryland's Law School as well.
Absolutely. So, Banneker High School, Duke University, undergrad, and the University of Maryland Law School.
Wow, wow. So we have that in common as well. I'm a graduate of the University of Maryland, not the law school, but... under the biotechnology.
No,
yeah, under the biotech program at the University of Maryland College Park.
Oh, excellent.
Yeah. So I'm just going to read a couple of things from your bio here. 1997, you began your career in Prince George's County as the assistant state's attorney. You made history, becoming the first full-time prosecutor and the youngest in that position.
So in 1997, I was hired as the first ever full-time domestic violence attorney in the office. And part of what's significant is back in those days, there wasn't a whole unit. In fact, there wasn't even one whole person.
Wow.
Until I was hired to focus on domestic violence. I think we know now, years later, how extremely important it is to have a unit of individuals who are trained and able to handle those cases. But to go to show that the focus really wasn't the same back 20 years ago,
right?
I was hired as the first ever full-time domestic violence lawyer. Now, when I was elected in 2010, then that's when we were able to make history. I was the first woman ever elected and also the youngest to be elected as the state's attorney in the county. So an honor in both regards.
Right. Absolutely. Well, wait a minute. I don't want to skip over your 2002 appointment as the county, you were appointed by the county executive to serve as the education liaison. And under your guidance, you were trying to get parental participation increased across the school district. So you were able to do that. So let's not skip over that.
Exactly. So you know what? I've had really marvelous opportunities. Mm-hmm. Education liaison, as you mentioned, started in following the election in 2002, and had an opportunity to work with parents and other stakeholders to host a series of events that talked about Parents Matter,
yes,
that Families Matter, talked about parental engagement, and worked in that position in the county executive's office. It gave me another opportunity to work with the school system, and actually I've been working in the school system now. Starting back in 97 when I was first hired as a prosecutor, we were required to adopt a school.
Okay.
And so it has been all along the journey an interest that I've had in making sure that I also contributed to what was happening in the school system.
Absolutely. Absolutely. So in 2003, you were appointed the executive director, by the executive director for the Revenue Authority for Prince George's County.
Yes, so I became the executive director of the Prince George's Revenue Authority, which really does operate the county's parking program and owns the New Carrollton, parking at the New Carrollton Hyattsville Justice Center, but we also, in partnership with WMATA, operated the New Carrollton, the garage there as well.
Right. And so I read that there was a 40% increase in revenue under your guidance?
So, yes, so which was very important. That agency was a critical, critical agency to the county in that we generated revenue. So the parking proceeds that we collect at the Revenue Authority contributed to the general fund of the county.
Mm-hmm.
And during the time that I was there, we had an opportunity to expand the parking program.
Absolutely.
And we increased the revenues during that period by 40%.
Okay, wonderful. So now I want to bring us a little closer to date in 2010 when you were, when you overwhelmingly won the seat that you currently hold right now as the state attorney. So let's talk about, you have many accomplishments. I know the domestic violence one, followed that very closely. I've been at various events where you were a keynote speaker and you talked about the advances under your guidance. So let's talk about that. And then let's talk about what you're gonna do in the next coming 10 months. I've been looking at your calendar with the clock and the countdown.
So you know what, it has been, a really full time, and as you mentioned, you know, the, being able to be elected has been just amazing. Over the last 7 years, we have worked on areas, and really, you know what, over the course of the last 20 years, I have been so blessed to work every day doing things that I love in this community, serving the community where I have grown up, as you mentioned, from a prosecutor, to working to aid in the area of economic development, to working in schools, and now as prosecutors, some of the areas that we have really focused on have really involved families and children. What more can we do to invest in and protect children? This means that we have been very aggressive in prosecuting sexual assault cases involving children.
Yes.
Unfortunately, we have had a good number of children who have been victims of domestic violence. In our county, who have been killed. Last year, we had 7 alone who were killed in Prince George's County in domestic incidents. It means that we've also worked to protect elders. We have an elder abuse unit, which is the only one in the entire of any prosecution office in the state. And we've also really aided in the decline in crime that we've seen. We had a cut of 40% in homicides during the first 4 years in office alone.
Wow.
40% cut in homicides. So we've seen the overall rate of violence decline, even though it's not erased. You know, we are not claiming victory that, that crime is over, but we have absolutely seen a lot of progress, and we credit that progress, I have to tell you, to our citizens.
Yes.
Who have been the absolute best partners we could imagine in terms of their own vigilance and involvement. So Prince George's County really has a wonderful, wonderful community, and we've enjoyed a good relationship with them, as well as with our police department.
Absolutely.
We have the police department, the sheriff's department, the county executive's office has been a fantastic partner, and the council. So through our partnerships and collaboration, we have really accomplished a lot in the area of public safety, and we are so proud of it, but we're not done yet, to your point.
Right.
As you mentioned, I have announced that I am now running for county executive.
Yes.
And part of the vision is, you know, when I came before voters in 2010, I asked them to envision with me a criminal justice system that worked for them and not against them.
Yes.
In other words, a system that held people accountable but was also really laser-like focused on prevention, keeping our children away from the criminal justice system in the first place, providing opportunities for that. And a lot of what we've done over the years, including workforce development, where we've created programs to help with first-time nonviolent drug dealers, to get them education and training, to get them jobs. These are things that I would like to do on a much larger level as county executive.
So, Angela,
So
let me ask you this question. So we have a lot of people who are tuning in, who are watching us live, who are watching us on elifemedia.net, watching our Facebook stream as we're having this interview, and I'm sure they're asking this question. Why Angela Alsobrook? Why now?
Well, you know, I think it is a simple. Is hopefully what people can look at is a record of accomplishment, a vision that is, I hope, been clear to people, you know, but the most important thing is really a clear record of being able to get things done. It's not just identifying problems, but I have spent the last several years both as a problem solver and as a bridge builder.
Yes.
And I think that's what we need really in our county executive, a person who is highly engaged. I think the thing that Prince Georgians know about me is I love people and I love Prince Georgians. And so nobody ever has to search for me. I'm out and about. I have been. Every day that I have been in office, I have spent some time making sure I'm available to people and that we're solving problems. We don't wait for the solutions to come to us. We've been very proactive, like I said, not just in fighting crime, but getting involved in education, doing what we could to assist businesses, including, for example, working with Kingdom Square, making sure that they were able to develop that project by clearing out human trafficking and prostitution around the Kingdom Square area, working with people like Mary Navies, who is a business owner in South County, who said if she hadn't met us, she was going to leave her business because of the robberies that were there. So in other words, a record of accomplishment, community engagement, and collaboration, working with people to get the job done.
I know that one of the things that I wanted to ask, you know, Prince George's County, with some your predecessor, soon to be predecessor, has been on a business boom. And so, you know, we have the MGM, we have a lot of things that are going on with raising funds for the Purple Line. We are trying to lure a large government agency to the county. And so that's great for the large businesses, but what about the small businesses that are leaving Prince George's County, as you just mentioned? What is your vision for those individuals?
Well, you know, I think that's a great question, is that we've done great with big boxes. I don't know that small businesses have left the county. I think you're right that we had the best opportunity. The small and local and medium-sized businesses, that's the truth. That is the backbone of our economy in Prince George's County, is the small and medium business. Now, one of the things I think we have to be proud of is Prince George's County has led the state of Maryland since 2011 every year in job growth.
Yes.
This means that Prince George's is a place that is on the move, and what we have to do is to continue to support, give real genuine support to small and medium businesses. I think small minority women-owned businesses, I think there's so many ways for us to do that, but we're going to have to be intentional. Most of that means that we're going to have to provide support in terms of credit. We're going to have to support them by bonding support where we can.
Yes.
And so really just helping to build capacity with small and medium-sized businesses, putting together we have to seek out some of the small and medium businesses in the county and ask those businesses, are there ways that we can support you? Some of the ones that we know are really doing great things. I think it has to be a part of our strategy to reach out to, not just wait for them to come to us, but to really be intentional about our outreach and finding ways to assist small and medium businesses to thrive.
Absolutely. And, you know, I know when I was thinking about the headquarters for my company, one of the things that I was concerned with was not finding the appropriate location that I felt was going to be conducive to the business environment that I'm in. And so I'm sure other business owners probably have that same concern. Real estate is very expensive in Prince George's County. And so small businesses, medium and small-sized businesses, you know, as you mentioned, we are the backbone. And I'm glad to hear you mention that you're going to be taking initiatives to attract and keep. It's important.
Oh, it's absolutely important. It really is. And as I said, and it's no exaggeration, that they really are the backbone of our economy. The larger businesses have really contributed greatly to our economy as well. But those small and medium businesses are critical. They really are. They are critical to that's where the bulk of the jobs are.
Yes.
And that's where that's where the future is for Prince George's and some of the local businesses. That's the best opportunity I think we have to bring into our county some of the businesses that residents have long been yearning for,
yes.
Some of the food establishments. I think we have great opportunity in mm-hmm. those areas.
Absolutely. And so as we look at, we're coming off the effects of the housing crisis that occurred several years ago. Some homeowners are still recovering. Some homeowners have left the county. Taxes are high in the county. Any insight, any plan towards, helping? What is your plan?
I think we do have to continue, as you said, to help all of the families who are still suffering the effects of the foreclosure crisis.
Mm-hmm.
As you know, much like the job creation, Prince George's County, I think, is to be credited in a lot of ways with a really amazing recovery that we've seen also in the housing market.
Yes.
As you know, last year alone, Prince George's County saw growth in home values by 15%.
Mm-hmm.
That was the highest that we've seen in the state.
Yes.
The state average is about 6%, but housing values increased last year, thank goodness, by 15 points. We're not finished yet
mm-hmm.
because there are a good number of families who are still suffering the effects of foreclosure.
Yes.
I think we have to do what we can to still be there to assist those families. But I believe that we have really come a long way
mm-hmm.
In terms of what we saw, just 6 years ago.
Absolutely.
That the recovery has been, fairly good.
Absolutely. So I recently in the news, I hear that several individuals have are throwing their hats into the same ring. And I know that there's many opportunities in government as government is changing. So as a standout, because like I said, you made history. And with this county executive appointment, you would make history again. Should you be elected to that position. So could you tell us how, or if you have already started thinking about when, I was just corrected, when you get elected to that position, your strategy, do you have like a 5-point plan, your must-do things that you want to get to right away?
Well, education is priority number one.
Mm-hmm.
I think it is clear to everyone. Well, let me just say this part. This is the good news about where we are. When we
yes.
came into office, nearly 7 years ago, I think you'll agree with me
mm-hmm.
that every conversation we had started with crime and corruption.
Yes.
We are now at a place in our county, and I think it is a really wonderful place to be, where education
mm-hmm.
is the topic of conversation. It is on the hearts of all of our citizens. It is at the top of the list, and it is where we will focus.
Yes.
We understand very clearly that if we see the real achievement increasing in the county, and we
mm-hmm.
see confidence increasing and trust increasing in the school system, that we'll find all of these other indicators will rise as well. In other words, when education improves, so does our ability to attract businesses,
mm-hmm.
so as well as our ability to keep our crime rate low,
yes.
so as well as our ability to see our housing prices go up. Now, how will we do that? I think it is going to require a lot of hard work.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not going to say it will be easy,
mm-hmm.
but it will come through the true alliance that we must have with parents
yes.
and teachers.
Yes.
It means that we're going to have to find a way to not only teach to and support children in schools, but the truth of the matter is we're going to have to really aid the total child,
mm-hmm.
meaning that we're going to have to find ways to contribute to their development inside and outside of the classroom.
Yes.
It means that we're going to not only invest in having good teachers
mm-hmm.
Who are well-paid and well-supported, standing in front of our kids every day, but it means also that we're going to have to find ways to bring social workers into our schools to aid the children in their development, because you know what? Intelligence is not fixed. In other words, intelligence can increase, but most of that happens through social and emotional support.
Absolutely.
So we're going to have to really have a comprehensive sort of approach to teaching children,
mm-hmm.
and that is going to include, again, an alliance between parents and the school system, because we can't do this without parents.
Absolutely.
That's the other reality, is that we mm-hmm. really need to make sure that we are allies to families, and that we make that clear. We are not just there for the kids. We're really going to have to be there for their parents as well.
Yes.
And to make sure that we're investing earlier, pre-K education is critical, that we have to get to our children so that they are even ready to start kindergarten, and provide opportunities and increased funding for pre-K education, as well as I think we're going to have to make additional investments in middle school. So there are there's a lot of work to be done, but I think education obviously is a cornerstone. Have to continue to focus and invest on public safety as well. There's no way we can go backwards in that area. And I think we're also going to focus as well on business and development. We're going to have to grow this commercial tax base.
Yes.
In Prince George's, we have for too long, on the backs of citizens through property taxes, tried to serve people by taxing them. We can't do that.
Let me hear you say that one more time. I need to hear that one more time.
What I'm saying is that we're going to have to increase and grow the commercial tax base, because there is no way that we should serve citizens basically by on the backs of citizens with property taxes.
That's right.
That's not the way to fund the government, is on the backs of citizens. We're going to have to grow the commercial tax base to pay for the things that we need. And the and property taxes, we have long understood that we have really burdened citizens with this, and this is not the way to fund the government. We're going to have to grow that commercial tax base. We are grossly underfunded in that area. That's the reason that business development, business growth, job growth also has to be a priority, as well as quality of life.
Absolutely.
You know, the trash collection, the leaf collection, the litter, these are things the citizens want and expect. And there ought to be an urgency about delivering those things to citizens. They need to feel that their tax dollars are benefiting them. I think it's a reasonable expectation that there's some very basic things that citizens expect, and we're going to have to deliver those things with an urgency.
Yes. And, you know, you everything that you mentioned just now is just absolutely on point. I'm getting comments on our feed. People are thumbs up, especially when you talked about the education, when you talked about the tax situation in Prince George's County, and many, many concerns. And you know, this has been an awesome discussion. I wish we could keep you on for another 30 minutes, but I know that you are very, very busy, and we have been extremely fortunate to have you on for the period of time that that you've been here with us. So if people want to donate to your campaign or volunteer, how would they do that? Could you give us some information?
You know, thank you so much for asking. And let me just say to all of your listeners, thank you, first of all, for tuning in and for listening. I want to thank you, Sylvia, for inviting me, and to thank all of you for letting me serve over these years. Let me tell you, it has been the greatest honor of my life. I have enjoyed every day of it. I look forward to continued service. My website is AngelaAlsobrook.com. If you go on there, you will see a link that will allow you to donate, as well as allow you to volunteer. We need as many people to get involved in this campaign as we can. We are calling it Fulfilling Our Promise. It's time, and I think it really is time for us as Prince Georgians to fulfill the promise that is Prince George's. This is the Prince George's is the crown jewel of Maryland.
Yes, it is.
Be very clear about that. It is the crown jewel of Maryland, but it takes all of our efforts to make sure that we hold ourselves accountable, that we work to the standard that we deserve in delivering the services and education and everything we need. So anybody, please, under the sound of our voice, who agrees with our values, I know that we all share. We want the same things for our families: safe neighborhoods, quality education, stable and secure futures for our aging relatives. These are things we all want. And let's work for it together. So AngelaAlsobrook.com.
Wonderful. Wonderful. And Angela, I didn't mention at the top of the hour that we are sorority sisters. We are distinguished.
Oh.
We are distinguished ladies of Delta Sigma Theta Sorority Incorporated.
I should have known. Yeah, that, you know what? And let me tell you, the sorors have been so supportive.
Absolutely.
It's unbelievable. But sisterhood, but service is a core value, right?
Absolutely.
And it's something we share in common. So thank you for
Absolutely.
That as well.
And thank you to our sorority chapter, Prince George's County Alumni Chapter, of which we're
and
both
congratulations
members.
Congratulations, too.
Yes.
You know, they just won Chapter of the Year. And
yes.
Congratulations to
yes.
Prince George's Alumni Chapter on winning Chapter of the Year nationally.
Yes.
For the wonderful work they do every day in our community.
Yes, and we appreciate them. And we especially appreciate you And we look forward to supporting you in any way possible that we can. And thank you for joining us this evening for this discussion. And thank you for everybody who listened in.
Absolutely. And thank you for having me. And thank you so much to all of your listeners. Good night, everybody, and God bless you.
God bless you.
Thank you. Good night.
Good night.
Bye-bye.
So we are going to take a one-minute break or maybe less, and we're going to come back in for the second part of the show with Haki and I. So, Angela Alsobrook, again, the Prince George's County State's Attorney, was on for our interview this evening, and she did announce recently that she is going to be running for the Prince George's County Executive's Office. So we are very excited about the opportunity of having her on. We'll be back in a few moments. This is Sylvia Johnson, and Haki has joined me in studio, so we are going to continue with the second half of the show.
All right. Yes, good evening, everybody. It's good to be here at eLife Media. So I just chiming in, listening in to our future county executive that's running for election next year. So you know, we'll see how it's going.
Yeah, she has, right. We have about 10 months.
Yes, before the next series
for that. Mm-hmm. But it was a great interview.
Yeah, great interview.
We got a lot of the questions in. Mm-hmm. I felt like she was very direct. She was very precise. And she's excited, and I'm excited, and I think there's a lot of enthusiasm around her.
Yes, indeed there is. Indeed there is. Young, up-and-coming superstar, you know, in the Prince George's County and state of Maryland. Mm-hmm. So, you know, it's good when you have somebody that has a clean record in Prince George's County. So, you know, it's always good. You know, we have to support those that, you know, are doing right and they have not necessarily been through the processes of having to feel like they have to be holding to someone, you know, a little independence there, a little independent of thought, fresh ideas. So that's why I support Ms. Alsobrook for
Alsobrook. Yes, she's
Alsobrook.
Yeah, say her name correctly.
Yeah, right.
It's Alsobrook.
Thank you.
So yeah, so you know, she Prince George's County resident, you know, went to school in D.C. She mentioned Banneker High School.
Right.
I think she said Duke University College and
University
of Maryland for law school and resides in the county, of course.
Mm-hmm.
And she's just very, very active in the community. And one of the things that she pointed out that, you know, I asked her about a 5-point plan if she had one. She talked about education right off the start.
Yeah, sure,
and,
she did.
You know, I think the county has had some issues with the education. You know, schools are very crowded, classrooms are crowded, and people want to know what is going to come next. And so I just think it's great that she was able to outline that and provide that information.
I agree. And, you know, we saw Ms. Alsobrook again, this time at the Prince George's County Chamber of Commerce meeting. Mm-hmm. So, you know, it was good that she was there because, you know, like you said, being concerned not just about the major corporations, such as the, you know, these executive roundtable groups that, you know, but, you know, being concerned of how do we take, for instance, the wealthiest county in the United States for African Americans and see what can happen to create these industries that are essential. And, you know, we talk about, you know, unemployment, underemployment. Mm-hmm. Well, various ethnic groups, for instance, they employ their own, you know, people. So they don't necessarily have these problems. So what has to happen, as she mentioned, in terms of education, that becomes essential.
Absolutely.
To compete in a global industry, you know, I mean, I'm sorry, a global marketplace. Right. So this is what, you know, needs to happen. Individuals need to take education serious, and we need individuals that, you know, that have the understanding of technology and, you know, various STEM. So I'm happy that she came there because what's happening, for instance, is sometimes some politicians, you know, they may not necessarily have a business orientation. You know, they want to be a social worker, you know, for instance. And, you know, of course, people talk about education, but, you know, bottom line to everything and what, you know, persons of African descent, black people here need to be, you know, having discussion about is show us the money, you know, like what, you know, what's, you know, I mean, we're a large percentage of the population in Prince George's County. Mm-hmm. It's like some folk gonna have to, you know, kind of do some deals and be in position. Like she said, she talked about building capacity.
Right.
You know, and this is where, you know, those joint ventures and partnerships and collaborations tend to come from. So,
well, you know, you have the large conglomerations that come into the county and
like who? Like MGM, like
and you know, small businesses are not afforded the opportunities to even.
I want to ask her.
Have a piece of some of those contracts, and so as small businesses, medium and small businesses, there has to be some initiative to reverse that.
Right.
If you live in the county, and you do business in the county.
Mm-hmm.
And you hold a business in the county.
Right.
Why can't you get a contract?
Yes.
In the county.
Yes. Well, that discussion came up before. Right. Previously, for instance, I mean, with Mr. Johnson, you know, who's going to be free soon. He's going to be home soon. Mm-hmm. You know, there was that discussion about, you know, who should get it, mm-hmm. you know, who should mm-hmm. get contracts. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I mean, there was a theory. I wasn't around. I didn't see everything, but I heard and read, you know, mm-hmm. that people were getting contracts and they were not necessarily totally qualified. It was just like, you know, homie hookup. Like, but, you know, well, we need to see, you know, capabilities, right?
Right.
Your capabilities have to be up to the level, to the standard.
Right.
You know, and I think that's fair, right?
It's fair. Yeah. And, I think under the Baker administration,
mm-hmm.
He distanced himself from that philosophy.
Right.
And so that was a great thing.
Mm-hmm.
We could actually see that occurring.
Right.
But we
right,
need
right.
to see more. So I believe with Ms. Alsobrook,
you're saying we need to see more.
We need to see more in terms of opportunities being presented based on capabilities and performance.
Yeah.
Not necessarily a who you know mm-hmm. type of scenario, but I think with Ms. Alsobrook, what she is proposing mm-hmm. is that she is going to take it a step further.
Mm.
So that the playing field becomes more evenly divided.
Right.
You know,
right
now, you know, you're a small business in Prince George's County. I think someone mentioned that at the chamber meeting.
That
a lot of small businesses feel like, okay, we don't have a chance on getting a contract in the county that we support, and so something different needs to occur.
Mm-hmm.
So
mm-hmm.
what is that something different?
Right.
So
right,
I believe that Ms. Alsobrook has the solution
mm-hmm,
to what
mm-hmm.
that something different is. She's been in government.
Right.
She's
right.
seen things. She's talked to people. She resides here. So she's no stranger.
Amen. Yes. Okay. That's good. Well, interesting. You brought up all this business. I'm going to kind of throw something out there. We didn't
sure.
necessarily plan to discuss this, but mm-hmm. let's add in to the discussion. You know, about first we're just gonna throw out our training that
mm-hmm.
we have coming up here.
Sure.
Can you speak to that training that's gonna be coming up?
Sure. On August 24th, we are having a training. It's actually a conference.
Mm-hmm.
Conference/training.
Right.
At our headquarters in Baltimore, Maryland, and it's going to be on government contracting, specifically on addressing RFIs, RFQs, and RFPs, which
responding
to those types of proposals for federal government contracts.
Right.
We're actually going to have a person in-house who's going to be working with us directly for the participants.
Mm-hmm.
She's going to go through one of the actual proposals.
Mm-hmm.
We're going to dissect that. So this is going to be a joint project between JI Solutions and Blueprint
mm-hmm.
Human Capital Company.
Mm-hmm.
Gloria Thornwell is the CEO and president
right.
of Blueprint, and she's
right.
going to be coming in for that training, and the training is going to have limited capacity.
Right.
We would like to have 15 participants,
mm-hmm.
and the reason that we are trying to keep that training small is because we want to have an opportunity for the person who's doing the training, Tanisha, to interact
right.
directly with individuals. So we want to make sure that, first of all, people have an opportunity to ask questions
right.
and participate and just understand the whole process.
Right. All right. Let me just learning objectives or learning
mm-hmm.
outcomes, what we want here. At the end of this half-day workshop, you will be able to define RFP, RFI, RFQ,
mm-hmm.
explain and describe how the federal government used each type of request, explain mm-hmm. and describe why it's critical to reply and how responding effectively can improve your chances of winning federal contracts.
Right.
Write more effective responses to RFPs and RFIs and prepare value.
Mm-hmm.
So who should attend? Let me just mention that.
Mm-hmm.
Business development teams, BDs. Capture teams, proposal writers, technical
mm-hmm.
writers, and pricing specialists. So those are some of the individuals that should attend this
right.
Workshop. So.
And so in addition to those individuals, we're also looking at business owners who have certain certifications, the 8A certification for one, the Hub Zone certification, veteran-owned certifications. You know, these are individuals who really benefit from this. Everybody can benefit from this training, but these individuals have set aside contracts specifically for them. And so this training will focus primarily on answering those types of questions. So the information is available. We've put it out on our Facebook. It's on YouTube. It's on LinkedIn. We can provide additional information at the conclusion. We can link that onto it. But, you know, that's one of the reasons that I really wanted to have a conversation with Ms. Alsobrook about businesses, small, medium and small businesses in the county, because, you know, a lot of us are trying to do the government contracting, but we also want to do state and local contracts as well.
Yes.
And we want to have an opportunity to do that.
Right. Yes, that's essential. And I was reading some reports preparing for the St. Louis trip, but, you know, in this area, for instance, the DMV, it's essential for individuals who refer to themselves as entrepreneurs to you know, be a part of this. You know, it's like, look, you know, this is how persons in this area obtain wealth. You know, like for instance, you have Simi Valley, you have Hollywood, you know, you have New York, Wall Street. Look, like, this is the ball game here. You know, so it's like, if you hear, you know, people that are in position. Some people have family members that are in position. So, you know, you just have to, you know, get outside of your comfort zone of what you traditionally were doing and show up and learn how your skill set and, you know, your background can be transferable to some of these needs that, you know, the different agencies in this area have, you know.
And the other thing, we were also saying to folks, don't worry if you've been in business for 2 years, 3 years, 4 years, 5 years, you can still have questions. And, you know, there is no shame in asking questions and learning. You will be surrounded by like-minded individuals, business owners who are also trying to obtain a clearer understanding of the process. So with that, you're in a comfortable place. You're in a comfortable place to gain information and to take your business to the next level.
Right, indeed. And you know, that made me bring up where we were this Saturday. We had the opportunity to attend the 125th anniversary of the historic Afro newspaper gala. Event. So this has been 125 years. Yes, gotcha, Black Diamond. 125 years of service both to Baltimore as well as to the D.C. market with the Afro newspaper. And Mr. Wallace, Rob Wallace, Robert, he wrote several books, Biff Group, but he's been a very sharp proponent of entrepreneurship. He has several books out, and one is called Black Wealth, but I read probably three or four of his books. I saw him at an Urban League conference, yes, because I want to be connected to everything. I don't want nothing to be missed, so
that's
I'll go.
And we had a great conversation with him on Saturday night well. Very approachable. And that's the other thing about, you know, businesses and business owners. Some people are not approachable. They get to a certain level where they feel like their people have to communicate with you through, you know, that type of thing. But, you know, he was approachable. We we held a conversation with him. You know, we talked about growing business and, you know, and that's what it's all about.
Indeed. You know? Indeed, yes. And, you know, certainly he's created a very distinguished multi-million dollar operation over the years, and so it was just good to see him and Stanley Tucker of Meridian Management Group. Who's the other MC that was present? Moyne.
I brought the program, but it's down in my bag.
Okay.
It's down in my bag. Yeah.
Doreen.
Oh, Maureen. No, that's Maureen Bunyan.
Yes. So she was
DC,
the
DC anchor person.
Yes, so she was one of the masters of ceremony. So as well as Hidden Figures. Hidden Figures.
The author of the book.
Yeah. Author of the book, Hidden Figures, was present. And so that was, you know, good to hear her story and how valuable it has the print media industry has been. You know, so what did you get out of that?
So, you know, one thing from the Afro, I mean, we grew up with the Afro, so we were very well aware of the Afro. But it was just nice hearing the historical aspect and the family connection, and the fact that there's still family involvement and individuals who have worked for the Afro for 20 to 30 years. And one gentleman, I believe he was there 30 years.
40. One person was there 40.
One lady was there for 40 years. So, you know, so we're talking about individuals who have dedicated their lives to media, to print media.
Maureen Bunyan.
Yes, Maureen.
Yes, go ahead.
That's what I said. Maureen Bunyan. So absolutely, I thought it was a phenomenal event. I'm so glad that you you purchased the
we went the VIP. That's right. Yeah, indeed.
So that we had an opportunity to speak
behind the scenes
with individuals. So it was a great opportunity, and I look forward to going to it, and it was not disappointing.
Margot Lee Shetterly is the name.
Are you saying it like
I'm
that?
Trying to pronounce her name. Margot Lee Shetterly.
Be careful.
No, look. S-H-E-T-T-L-E-L-E-R. So, Hidden Figures Lady. That's what I wanted to call her first. Hidden Figures Lady. So, it was just a good experience. Connecting, seeing people I haven't seen in years. Kwesi Mfume and several of the local council persons and state delegates and some of the congresspersons and several amazing sponsors. March Vernal Home here, the Murphy Law Firm, Ada White Pettit, we listened to in the Baltimore market.
And we actually had a chance to speak with him briefly.
Yes.
We didn't want to hover over him while he was enjoying his meal, but we did have a chance to say hello to him.
Yes, indeed. So I'm looking forward to the Maryland Legislative Caucus weekend where Dr. Frazier has spoke over the past, he spoke last year, and, you know, I've gone and participated, and I assisted to get Dr. Frazier there to speak last year, so at the breakfast, and then we went to the dinner. So so that's the Maryland Legislative Caucus. That's going to be coming up, and Cheryl Glenn is the Maryland Legislative Caucus chair. So, you know, it's like, well, some people, what are you doing? Why are you always, you know, going to these different places? It's like, look, you got to be where various levels of power is. You got to understand, you know, wealth.
Yes.
And, you know, and access and networking. So, and several of those individuals, they've purchased my book over the years, Mission Unstoppable, Extraordinary Stories of Failures, Blessings. So let me just do
a... I know,
we're going to plug both of them. And this is Dr. George C. Frazier. I'm sorry, let me hold it up.
Yeah,
right
that way.
So that's Mission Unstoppable. Of course, you can get that from successscholarhaki.com. successscholarhaki.com. I didn't mention it yet. So we had the children on 2 weeks ago here. Ona and John Leslie Brown. And we had Dr. Dennis Kimbrough last week. And we broke, you know, all kind of listening audience growth records. So I'm excited about, you know, the growth of eLife Media and being here and doing that. And, of course, your book. So let's do a plug, special plug, Daily Dose.
No. So my book is Daily Dose of Direction for Women in Business. I like to give the full title because we have several distinguished authors who participated in this project.
Shout
so
to
I don't
want to,
I don't want to, you know, not give the correct title of the book. So that is the...
Oh, thank you.
That is the book.
Right.
And we had a power-filled weekend.
I'm actually a little tired.
Now. But this evening's interview with Angela Alsobrook gave me the energy, that I needed. And so I'm so very, very excited.
Right, right.
And so, I would like to thank everybody who tuned in tonight. We appreciate you, and I would like to send, you know, prayers and blessings to my family in South Carolina on the passing of my aunt, Margaret Boware. And I'll see you guys very soon. Love you. And Haki, we have about 1 minute.
So next week, let's talk about next week. We got a health show. I won't be in the studio,
so next week is going to be awesome. For those of you who are vegan, and even those of you who are not vegan, you're going to be excited. I'm going to have Kamatne Rollins. Many of you know him from Vegan Pro.
In the studio.
In the studio. Right, he's also the founder of Fit Fathers. He has been on Channel 5. Talking about health and wellness and fitness for men, families. So that's going to be on Monday. And so I'm so excited about that. He was very instrumental in me becoming more serious about my vegan journey.
Awesome.
Next week. That's Monday.
Oh, beautiful. Great. Looking forward. So, we can close on out. Success Scholar, HAKI.com. So you can look. We'll have this interview up on YouTube in a couple minutes. So definitely thank you for sitting in.
Always.
And hosting that for our next county exec, right?
Yes, the next county exec.
Yeah. So we're gonna make it happen. When you got the Success Scholar and Sylvia on the team, you got it. It's already done, real talk, for real. All right, so definitely everybody.
Have a great night.
Peace.
See you guys later.